This bridge building activity can be a lot of fun, and it can inspire the engineer inside your young bridge designer. You and your young engineer get to decide how you want to build the bridge, with certain material and requirements. The materials list is in the magazine article. The requirements are that the bridge use only the available material and that the bridge be 5 popsicle sticks long. The rest is up to you and your young engineer. How many sticks to use, how many levels to the bridge, how to fasten the parts, those are all decisions for you two to make. We also assign a value to each part so you can factor in cost, which every engineer needs to do in the real world. In the end, you'll see how much your bridge can hold before collapsing. We'll give you a formula to rate your bridge based on the materials you used to construct the bridge and how much weight it was able to bear. Before we start building, here are some real engineering concepts to keep in mind.
We're here today to build your own truss. So this is a program that came out of the Xplore summer workshop that we do at the University of Michigan. And it's also featured in the Michigan Engineer magazine, where all the materials that we're using here today are listed. But before we get started, I want to talk a little in terms of truss bridges. Do you know what types of shapes trusses are made out of?
Triangles.
Triangles is a good guess. What happens if you push that square? Yeah, it's going to fall over, right? So if you make a truss bridge out of squares, it's not going to be very stable. And it's actually going to eventually fall down when you put some load on the top of it or a car drives over it. So as you mentioned, you're going to want to try to make your truss bridge out of triangles. We can think also in terms of your truss bridge, some of the forces that are occurring. Have you heard of anything called tension? So tension is essentially if you pull apart, which causes the squares here to increase in size, right? Now, if we have compression, then we're going to push, which causes the squares to
shrink,
yes. So when we have a bridge, the bridge actually sits like this, and the bridge tends to smile, right? So the squares on the bottom increase, and the squares on the top decrease. So it means that we have tension on the bottom and compression on top. The sticks that you're using are going to take these tension and compression forces. So your typical bridge, an example of the bridge, will look something like this. And we're going to do this using 38 popsicle sticks, 11 bolts, 33 nuts, and then 4 rubber bands. And you're going to use these to build your own truss bridge that we're going to test. Now, the one thing with a truss bridge is it's not just the materials that you use. Each material has a cost. So we want to look at how much weight your bridge holds versus how much your bridge actually costs and see how you do in terms of that. Why don't you go ahead, and if you have any questions, I'm more than happy to answer any of them. So one thing to keep in mind is that you probably want to put a nut on the inside and then a nut on either side of the other side of the truss. It'll help to keep it stable and strong. And your bridge should be 5 members across the bottom in terms to make sure it has the right length, okay? You can always build one side first, so put all of the pieces on, don't put any nuts on initially, and then put all the nuts on for the one side and start working on the second side, because then you'll know exactly what that second side's supposed to look like. You're coming along, you got 3 of them set.
Doing a great job, Deary.
There you go. And I'll help out some with getting the nuts on. And that's a time-consuming process.
Lefty-loosey, righty-tighty.
And then once you get the whole side completed and all the nuts on the one side, what you want to do is put another set of nuts on, a little less than an inch, for the second side to sit on. You just want to put them down far enough that all of the members fit without, and you'd be able to get a second nut on the top of them. And then once you have both sides finished, you definitely want to make sure you tighten everything up. And since you didn't use the rubber bands when you made your bridge, you can return them and get a refund. Thank you.
In order to test your bridge, you'll need to suspend it between 2 tables. You'll also need a way to hook a bucket under the bridge. A small block of wood with an eye hook can work. Now is a good time to take pictures of your bridge. It won't be the same after the test.
So you want to go ahead and fill the bucket with sand. Now, some people, when they're filling the bucket with sand, think that if they pour it slowly, it works better. So if you look at the top of it, you can see it's starting to twist a little. Whew. So I think your bridge is done. So what we're going to do now is we're going to weigh it and see how much weight that your bridge was able to hold. It's 24.47 pounds. Very good. And your bridge cost $21,860. A lot of money, huh? So your bridge quality score, which is just your weight held times 1,000 divided by your bridge cost, ended up being 1.12. And anything over 1 we consider very good. So you had a very good bridge design. So congratulations.
Good luck to you and your young engineer. This activity was adapted from MConnect's Xplore Engineering Summer Camp. You can learn more at engine.umich.edu.
Codes have really come a long way since some major earthquakes. The 1994 Northridge earthquake, the 1995 Kobe earthquake, both really caused a look at how we design steel structures.